whoever you are and wherever you are on your journey of life and faith, you are welcome to the virtual worship service of the Willow Street Church for the weekend of July 12th. I am Ron Bohannon, pastor of the Willow Street Church. Associate Pastor Deb Landis will be bringing our message a little later in this service. We will also be celebrating Holy Communion in this service, so if you haven't already, please pause the video now and gather something to serve both as bread and to serve as cup. Whatever you have available is certainly fine. The importance isn't the substance used, it's the grace of God present with us in the celebration. Also, please put on your calendar the date of August 2nd. You locals are welcome and invited to join us in an outdoor worship experience at 9 a.m. that Sunday morning. We will be physically located in a tent erected in the large field behind our church building. Please bring a lawn chair if you have one, and a spare if you can for those who aren't able to bring one of their own. And please let us know by calling the church office if you plan to attend so that we might make appropriate decisions regarding social distancing. Please dress for warm weather, though we will have commercial fans to circulate the air under the tent. Now let us be called to worship as lay reader Don Coverdale and I lead us.
Jesus is the true vine, and we are the branches.
Connected to Jesus, connected to bear fruit.
Connected to Jesus, or we wither away.
Connected to Jesus, or useless.
We come to worship Jesus, the true vine.
Staying connected and bearing good fruit.
Yeah. us then, oh God, how I need.
Today's scripture lesson is from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He takes away every branch that does not bear fruit in me. He prunes every branch that bears fruit so that it will bear more fruit. You are clean already because of the word that I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it remains in the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who remains in me, and I in him, bears much fruit, because apart from me, you can accomplish nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown out like a branch and dries up. And such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire and are burned up. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want, and it will be done for you. My Father is honored by this, that you bear much fruit and show that you are my disciples. Just as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Remain in my love. If you obey my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commandments and remain in his love. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hey kids, do you know where grapes come from? You might just think they appear on the shelf of a grocery store.
But actually, they're a fruit of a plant and they grow on a vine. When the time is right, little branches come out of those vines, and then little grapes start to grow.
Today, we're going to learn how Jesus used a parable of grapes to teach lessons.
So let's jump in! Jesus starts by saying, he is like the grapevine, and his Father is the gardener. The gardener's job is to cut off the branches that are not producing fruit. This helps the other branches that are producing fruit to produce even more.
Then Jesus tells the people that they are like the branches. They can't be healthy if they are not connected to the vine. In other words, if they aren't connected to Jesus, they can't live a life that honors him. And if they aren't connected to the vine, they will eventually die.
He ends this parable by talking about love. He told the people they should obey him and stay in his love, just like he stays in the Father's love.
He also tells them that they should love each other like he loves them. So what's the point of this grape story?
Jesus is the vine and we are the branches. This means we need Jesus in order to grow, just like the vine and the branch.
So if we don't have Jesus, we don't grow. If we stay connected to Jesus, we'll produce fruit.
This doesn't mean grapes are going to be coming out of your ears. We're talking about the fruit of the Spirit.
Things like kindness, goodness, thankfulness, and self-control.
These things are important to God. Remember verse?
Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So if we don't have Jesus, we can't produce any fruit.
The first fruit of followers of Jesus is love. The reason why Jesus talked about love at the end of the parable is because it's really important.
His two greatest commandments is to love God and love others.
And because God loves us so much, we need to love him back and love other people.
So kids, next time you sit down to eat grapes, make sure you know what makes them grow.
And remember, through God, you can also produce fruit.
Good morning. Tourists in London can visit Hampton Court to see a 250-year-old grapevine that still produces over 500 of bunches of grapes a year. They call it the Great Vine. It's amazing because some of its branches are hundreds of feet away from the main vine. They say it is the longest and oldest grapevine in the world. I'm here today to tell you it isn't. Vineyards would have dotted the countryside where Jesus and his disciples walked. Picture them walking along vines heavy with ripened fruit. Jesus touches a vine and says, "I am the vine, you are the branches." The disciples would have known and understood the significance of that. Vineyards were essential to Israel's economy, and they were part of its culture and tradition. It was a good lesson for disciples, but not so much for us because we're not vineyards. We don't raise them. We do occasionally have a good glass of wine. What we do know is what it takes to be a gardener. We know you have to know what you're doing. I have no green thumb. I went out in the spring to pull up the weeds, and I couldn't tell the difference between the weeds and the plants. So I called my expert, my mother, and she said, "Deb, pull on the shoot. If it gives you trouble, it's a weed. If it pulls out in your hand, it's your plant." My mom's a comedian. I bet two of our more notable gardeners, Bernie and Paul, can share a story or two about their garden and how to grow crops. But you know what they say. What happens in the garden stays in the garden. For gardeners as well as vineyards, the best fruit comes from the character of the vine and the skill of the gardener. In our scripture today, Jesus says the Father is the keeper of the vineyard, and he says he is focused on the production of fruit. As a skillful gardener, the Father plants Jesus as the true vine. You see, Israel was supposed to be the true vine, but they weren't a very good ambassador for God. They were reckless with their sins. They were obstinate in asking for forgiveness. And they seemed to only go to God when they were at the absolute end and had no other choice. But Jesus, he deserves the title of true vine. He has faithfully executed all of God's purposes in all ways and according to his will. Wow, with the perfect gardener and the true vine, the fruit produced will be outstanding. Wait, there's one thing missing, the branches. Jesus says, "I am the vine, you are the branches." 8 times in this chapter, Jesus speaks of branches that produce fruit for the vine. Clearly, the vine is in control. It uses the branches just to produce the fruit. Thinking about control, when the hair salons reopened this month, people were flying to land that first seat in the salon. I missed the line, but I think they needed a hair traffic controller. Without control, the struggle is real in being a branch. We would rather be the vine. We would rather decide how we will be fruitful. We would rather decide which we're going to produce. But it just doesn't work that way. We are to focus on branch living. That focus is to build a strong relationship with Jesus. Think of the relationships that you have had in your life. Are they still going strong? We can't guarantee that the connections we make will always remain. If you're lucky, you might have one of those relationships that has lasted a lifetime. There were two very, very mature women who had been friends since kindergarten. They had enjoyed each other's company on adventures and gone through the ups and downs of their family life. And now they met together one afternoon a month for tea. During one visit, the friend looked at the other and said, "I know you're going to be mad, but I have to ask you this. I don't remember your name. It's on the tip of my tongue. Give me a hint." Her friend looked back at her for some time, and then she shrugged and said, "When do you have to know?" No matter what kind of relationship we have here on earth, Jesus and a relationship with him is going to be out of this world, literally. You see, Jesus and a relationship with us is never going to stand us up, put us down, take us for a ride, give us a line, or break our heart. He will never forget our name. He knows the hair on our head. He knows us inside and out. And yet he still loves us. It is with this love in mind that he says in our scripture today, "Remain in me." In our scripture, remain is the only action a branch is to do. Remain in me. In verse 9, he says, "Remain in my love." In verse 10, he says, "Remain in my love by following my commandments." Remain. It means abide, hang on, persist. How do we abide? We have to concentrate on the things that are going to intensify and strengthen our relationship with Jesus. Get a routine for regular prayer. Make sure you have time to read your Bible, for Bible study as well. Go to worship. Do some service. Soul search. And don't forget to ask for forgiveness. When we put our energy and time into a union with Jesus, we are able then to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and it flows from Jesus to and through us. And that Holy Spirit causes us to produce the fruit that reflects the character and love of Jesus. A boy was shivering in front of a department store. It had a display of warm winter clothes. A woman was passing by and noticed that he had holes in his shoes and his jacket was two times too small. She asked him if he would like a new outfit. When he was all dialed up in his new shoes and his warm clothes, he looked up at her and said, "Lady, are you God?" She said, "No, but I'm one of his children." And in very seriousness, he nodded and said, "I knew you had to be related." Branch living in the right way can't hide its relationship and identity to Christ. Have you ever seen a vine with one branch? What kind of fruitfulness can that achieve with one branch? While we are focused on abiding, remember, we're not abiding alone. The true vine consists of an entire system of branches working together in and for the vine. We call this system of branches by another name. Can you guess what it is? That's right. The body of Christ. Adam Powles writes that all believers, you and I, when united by Christ by faith, find ourselves also united to one another in Christ. There is no society more sacred than Christ's church. This is the unity that Jesus calls his branches to. And Jesus says exactly what he expects to do through this union of branches. I'm going to read it to you in John 17, 22 and 23 of the Message. I'm praying not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me because of them and their witness about me. The goal is for all of them to become one heart and mind. Just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, so they might be one heart and mind with us. Then the world might believe that you, in fact, sent me. The same glory you gave me, I gave them. So they'll be as unified and together as we are, I in them and you in me. Then they'll be mature in this oneness and give the godless world evidence that you've sent me and loved them in the same way you've loved me. We are united in our identity in Christ, so the world will know of God's love. It is clear that bearing fruit is not optional. We're in it together. Jesus said in Matthew 7:15, "You will know my disciples by their fruit." Donald Barnhouse writes that the natural result of abiding in Christ is the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit is singular. The Beatles sang a song called "All You Need Is Love." And the nine characteristics in the fruit of the Spirit all stem from love. And I love the way that Barnhouse describes each one. Joy is love singing. Peace is love resting. Patience is love enduring. Kindness is love's touch. Goodness is love's character. Faithfulness is love's habit. Gentleness is love's self-forgetfulness. Self-control is love holding on to the reins. The test of our unity and our identity in Christ is that our fruit is born from love. Hudson Taylor writes about a boy who would leave his bedroom through his window, shimmy down the fruit tree, and leave without his parents knowing it. One day, Dad said, "I'm going to cut down that old fruit tree. It hasn't produced any fruit for years." That night, the boy and his friend had a bushel of apples, which they tied all over that fruit tree. In the morning, Dad couldn't believe his eyes. He said, "Look, there are apples all over the tree. What's amazing is that it's a pear tree." Unless the fruit is a result from the love and character of Jesus living in us, it's not the real thing. On close inspection, God knows exactly which fruit is artificial. Artificial fruit is born out of fear, hatred, resentment, or anger. It's tied to the branches by self-serving actions. This is not branch living. This is not living in unity with each other. It's like hanging apples on a pear tree. What then becomes to the identity of Christ? What has become to our evidence to the godless? Where in all of this is seen the love of God? We have a great responsibility to be the body of Christ. We must compare our living and our actions with the fruit of the Spirit. They are the measuring stick that reveals if the love of Jesus and the urging of the Holy Spirit really flows within us. We are not here for our own good. We are here to be unified together in Christ with the love of all believers, shown by supporting each other for the good of the body. Our lives are to give evidence of God's love. And that is seen from the fruit we produce. it's seen in our lives. So let's ask ourselves this morning, how am I doing in my branch living? Am I getting enough of the Holy Spirit? Am I attached strongly enough to have a good flow? Is my connection to the vine as strong as ever? Can you see evidence of the fruit of the Spirit in my actions? How am I doing in my unity with other branches? Am I being supportive? I said in the beginning that the grapevine didn't have the claim to being the oldest or longest vine in the world. There is only one true vine, and that is Jesus Christ. He has been here since the beginning of time, the beginning of this world, and he wraps himself all around the world, and he will go on forever. He offers his branches everlasting life. The true vine is the greatest there ever was, is, or will be. Now is the time to remain in him. Now is the time to deepen your relationship with Jesus if you seem to be losing your grip. Now is the time to join in unity and identity with the other branches in the system, in the body of God. Because those who remain are promised that they will enjoy all that Jesus has to offer, all that Jesus has been given by the Father, now and through eternity. It's truly a great day to be a branch of the living vine. Amen.
Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Abide in me as I abide in you. You cannot bear fruit all by yourself. You need me. You need each other. I ask you, abide in me at this table."
Lord, we confess that we have not lived up to the calling you first whispered in our ears. We have gone astray. We have been weeds in isolation and thorny vines that carry no seed, choking out brothers and sisters of fruitfulness, stealing their sunshine, allowing no rain to fall upon new seed. We are guilty of serving our own needs rather than contributing to the whole. We are not connected to you. We are not connected to one another. Forgive us. Connect us, graft us once again in grace.
There is good news. Christ came in the flesh to abide with us. God's love still grows in the world. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. Lord, you are the vine, we are your branches.
The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Like trees, let us aspire to raise our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the God of relationships.
We give thanks and praise.
Holy God, to you, the Creator who gave us vines to climb, trees to lay down in the shade, and fields to run and play, you are the source of our life. All life flows from you and connects to the river of your purpose, the kingdom that is here and is coming fuller and fuller each day. Your love flows, eternally chasing us to the sea. Our love has failed. We have splashed up on dry banks and that you did not intend for us. Yet you still part the waters. You still pour out your baptismal love. You still speak through your prophets and teachers. And so we join together in that rushing water that flows from the heavens to the earth.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You, Jesus, flow as the source, the love. You are the vine. We are the branches. You taught us that when we connect with you,
we grow. When we are not connected, we wither and die. You know what it is to die. You are the seed that was planted.
Christ has died.
You give us the faith in your church, a growing, living plant of your creation.
Christ is risen.
You give us the hope in the kingdom.
Christ will come again.
On the night in which Christ died for us, he took the bread, wheat that had been grown in the fields gathered and prepared. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, connecting each of them to the single loaf. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
After supper, he took the cup, grapes from the vine, crushed and poured out freely for all to share. He gave thanks, gave it to disciples, inviting him and them to be in the vine. Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new relationship, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of brokenness. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Pour out your Holy Spirit here on your branches. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of the field and the vine. Make this cup and this bread be for us the body and blood of Christ Jesus.
Connect your branches to your vine so that all may grow in your love and grace.
All this we pray in the name of the vine grower, the vine, and the Spirit of life within. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, we would grow with you and bring forth fruit that is pleasing to you, fed by your living water, giving nourishment to others. Lord, we would grow with you. Amen.